Hi everyone, and welcome to the All Things ITSM Global Podcast. We're coming to you from ITSM 15 in London. I'm Kirsty McGowan, I'm here with Rob Stroud.
Hi there.
Barclay Ray.
Hi Kirsty.
And it's our pleasure to be chatting with Tony Price from Hewlett Packard Enterprise. Hi Tony.
Hi, nice to meet you.
So Tony, tell us a little bit. I know that you've started to get involved with IT4IT in your practice. If people out there don't know what that is, give us a quick sketch.
Okay, so in October this year, at the Open Group event in Edinburgh, IT4IT was formally launched as a vendor neutral standard. And for me personally, I think it's one of the biggest things that's hit our industry for some time. I'm really, really excited about it. I think IT4IT brings a missing component which we've never had. That's a reference architecture for running the business of IT. And the whole concept of bringing in value chain and value stream thinking is something which is quite unique, which I've never seen before. And personally, I just think it's a work of genius that they've actually put something into a reference architecture which makes us all focus on value.
So what just for the uninitiated, what is value stream and value chain?
Okay, so Porter's value chain thinking was applied to a reference architecture, so looking at IT as a single value chain, a value chain which is supported by various functions but broken down into four very fundamental value streams. Value streams are detect to correct, request to fulfill, requirements to deploy, and strategy to portfolio. Right. So if I take the first one, detect to correct is an easy one to start with. For years we've been doing work around incident management, problem management, monitoring, alerting, but at last it looks at a life cycle of bringing detect to correct everything together. So why am I excited about it? Well, that's because my clients, my people that I've been working with, the ITIL world I've been part of for years, we've all been doing this, but now we've now got a language which we can use, which steps us up a level. But more importantly, when we start looking at detect to correct as a value stream, we see where we've got broken value streams because there'll be something missing. So it might be an integration, it might be a lack of process, or it could be somebody that's not got an accountability or responsibility. And by looking at that, instead of just picking on a tool and saying, I'm going to have the best in the world, we can now suddenly say, well, actually, there's no point having the best in the world, because if it breaks the value stream, let's look at that.
So I was listening to a webcast the other day about IT4IT, and it's available now. If anybody wants to visit the Open Group, they can, of course, listen to it. But who else was involved in the development of IT4IT besides yourselves and, you know, there's some other big names.
Yeah, some very big names. So there's no one organisation can claim total sort of they created it, which is, again, a good thing for IT4IT. Yeah. So a number of big organisations, Shell from a non-vendor, a customer perspective, probably the most instrumental in getting IT4IT where it is today. But other organisations like Achmea, a big insurance company in the Netherlands, are heavily involved in this. But also, if you look at now the founding sort of organisations, Accenture were involved, HP obviously have been involved in this, and a number of other vendors. So there's no one big organisation who's got a monopoly on it. And the beauty of the Open Group by nature is they're creating everything which is open. So now any other organisation can use it. So there's now over 70 members of the IT4IT forum now.
Have you had much feedback since the launch in Edinburgh?
Which is really nice for me. We've won a big chunk of work down in Australia, which is all based on IT4IT. So clients are using it. It's not theoretical. You know, people are actually using this. And today, just speaking at this event, the more people I speak to, the more people say the language, the vocabulary. It's like when they first found ITIL. They look at it and go, wow, where did this come from? And I actually really applaud the Open Group for what they've done. I think some excellent work they've done in there. And I think that collaboration between a number of vendors, number of user organisations, has created something quite unique.
How does it, briefly, how does it tie in with things like ITIL and COBIT and other existing models, frameworks, whatever you want to call them?
So, very good question. I think, again, the Open Group have been both very professional and quite clever in that they haven't tried to replace things like ITIL. They've basically acknowledged formally that ITIL, COBIT, and various other approaches, and certainly people like the TOGAF guys and TOGAF people will all recognise where TOGAF fits and things like this. So instead of replacing everything, they've acknowledged them and used them. So within the framework, anybody who's got existing investments in ITIL or COBIT, they're not throwing any of this away. Yeah. They're building on it. And they've not tried to replace it and say, throw everything away and start again.
So this is the way you can get ITIL guys and TOGAF guys.
Absolutely.
And we can talk to each other.
Well, I'm yet to find an environment where I can't apply IT for IT. And the beauty of it for me is I can go and speak to an architect and I can lift it up from an architectural perspective. I can go and speak to the business and I can take it down into IT. I can go and speak to the security analyst and the security risk guys. And I can go and speak to the COBIT guys. And I can speak to the auditors. And it gives me a language which I can bring us all together based on that common reference architecture.
Right.
Something I've never had before. And that's why I'm getting very, very excited by it.
So the next question is, so as we look at the, and I've looked at the model very closely, and as we look at the changing, evolving world now of IT consumption, let's be clear, we're rapidly moving to a hybrid world where part of our load, you know, one of the estimates of 36% of production workload now is public cloud, right?
Yep.
Not in-house, not managed service provider. Mm-hmm. How can the model be applied in those sorts of hybrid environments where workloads are running about the place?
Okay. So various different ways. For the cloud providers themselves, there's a way of applying it and using it. For the consumers, there's a way of using elements of it as well. Give you an example. In a cloud, if something fails, somebody still has to detect it and correct it. Mm-hmm. Somebody still has to do it. A lot of stuff in cloud is about provisioning and faster provisioning so we can consume. Mm-hmm. So that whole request to fulfill is just as important. So I'm taking you through the value streams. And obviously, as a consumer, I want that fulfillment. I also want to put requirements and get them deployed. Mm-hmm. So that it applies just as much for the cloud provider and the cloud consumer. Mm-hmm. And again, it's the strength of the IT for IT reference architecture, which I like. And what it's not tried to do is make itself specific for one specific type of delivery, such as cloud. It's been generic, and it allows you to think then about the velocity issues that you've got to have in the cloud. It doesn't describe the velocity issues, doesn't describe how you do that. It gives you the components that you need so that then you can do that.
Well, one thing then that's occurring to me, I mean, it's called IT for IT, so I'm guessing it's for IT. It's not for business people, is it? I mean, because the language of the value streams does sound more, to me, potentially acceptable than incident, problem, configure, you know. I mean, what kind of interaction do you have with business people on this, or are you just selling it to enterprise IT people?
For once now, I can stand in front of the business and have a conversation which they can understand. If I take the value streams again, I'll start with detect to correct. If I can say to the business, you want IT to fix something before you know about it, straight away the business goes, that's exactly what I want. Mm-hmm. I was talking about an example where a particular customer I was talking to, where their IT department was talking about a single pane of glass. The customer had no idea what IT was talking about. What we did was we talked about the fact that it was request to fulfill. Mm-hmm. So yes, you're right. The name IT for IT, it's the name. Yep. That's what it's called.
Yep.
So it's just like ITIL's a name.
It's the bit that worries me a little bit. Yeah. It's just the fact that it is IT.
It can give people the wrong view. And
we're sort of trying to preach the whole IT's in everything. IT's just part of the business. And then this comes out and it sort of almost seems to be picking IT up again and moving it over to the side.
And the way I always open my descriptions of it is to say a vendor neutral reference architecture for running the business of IT.
Right.
I deliberately state that, and that's what the open group will state as well, because it's not just about internal IT, it is about running the business. Yeah.
So I agree with that statement. It's not just about internal IT. Like Barclay, I share some concerns over the name. But if I go look at my data at Forrester, what it tells me, and the vendor announcements I'm starting to see out there now, very soon we're going to have this notion of end user development, where end users are actually going to be able to plug and play and build end user applications that run on cloud platforms or even hybrid platforms. So I'm not sure, and by the way, the framework is definitely applicable in that scenario. the name, if you go and mention it to an end user looking to put out an app, is probably not going to worry about it too much.
I say it doesn't concern me. Yeah. It's just IT.
I can only agree with you there. I do think the name is going to be an interesting challenge. I'm sure the Open Group will tell you lots more about why they debated it, why they went through various different names, some of which was probably less appropriate than the names that they came to. So the name it is at the moment is the name
mind
it
bubbles.
Is.
We should have a debate on that one.
It was only like ITIL was Gitten originally on it. So.
Yeah. We remember that.
Yeah. Well, thanks a lot for your time this afternoon, Tony. It's been a pleasure chatting with you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.